As usual, we'll start with a prayer. May I console as well be consoled. May I understand as well be understood. For forgiving, we are forgiven. In dying to self-centeredness, we are born to the deathless. The topic, as you know, what we are going to discuss is where you become very fearful like this, very fearful. But the job of this talk is to make you fearless. And that is what I am going to do. And the topic is, must be the toughest one given to me, managing coagulopathy in subjects with massive PPH. एक तो PPH हो रहा है और उसके साथ में हुआ coagulopathy. ये क्या क्या बदनसीबी है वो माँ की. What bad luck for the mother and what bad luck for the mother as well as the attending obstetrician and the entire team. And I agree, the previous lecture has given you an idea as to how you should go about. But let us go now in the clinical idea of this, the clinical perspectives. And that is here. A Scottish study has shown that in Scotland, around 11 PPH cases occur per week. Now that's quite a big figure in such a major or such an advanced setup, of which major obstetric hemorrhages, where blood loss is more than 2.5 liters or require more than or equal to 5 units, is 2 per month. And massive obstetric hemorrhage, 1 per year. Probably doesn't go to 1 per year because they act very fast. And that is where they define it. And we also agree that it is defined as a loss of more than 2.5 liters of blood and is associated to a need for admission to critical care and or hysterectomy. Now, there is one very recent study, relatively recent study, which has shown the hazard and the danger of coagulopathy. The presence of coagulopathy leads to one massive transfusion need, hysterectomy, and significant morbidity, and I am adding even significant sequelae. Coagulopathy in PPH is the single most important predictor for massive transfusion and hysterectomy, and it is and the ultimate outcome. Very quick to pathophysiology, and I know I might bore you a little, where I am going to take you to the coagulation mechanism. And this underlying disorder, this has been taught to us by our teachers in physiology. And we know this, that the systemic activation of coagulation leads to enhanced fibrin formation, microvascular thrombosis, and organ failure. But what we in massive PPH face is here, consumption of platelets and coagular clotting factors leading to bleeding. There is a washout. There is a washout. There is these factors are just fountaining out or just going out, oozing out of the maternal system. As a result of this, the making of the blood clot, where the clotting factors convert prothrombin to thrombin, and thrombin in turn helps fibrinogen to be converted to fibrin. वो clotting factors ही नहीं है, they are not there. Just as what we were saying when we are young people, we had this song, वो दिल कहाँ से लाऊँ तेरी याद जो भुला दे. Similar to that, वो clot factors कहाँ से लाऊँ जो bleeding को बंद कर दे. They are all washing out, they are just going away, and that is where, therefore, I say that करेला ऊपर से नीव चला. Majority of women who ultimately develop PPH do not have any such preceding factor. That is scary. That is scary. Massive PPH can occur without any preceding factor, and majority is in that way. So every pregnancy is at risk. So therefore that bell is required, because it doesn't come planned. You know, the previous speaker showed a bell, a gong. Therefore it is required. Ye kabhi bhi baj sakta hai. The coagulopathy associated with massive PPH may be due to hemodilution, as I say, also failure of liver and synthetic function as occurs, or with acute liver failure of pregnancy and disseminated intravascular coagulation, where as situations which are dear to my heart obstetric vasculopathies in the entire lining of the maternal system, which can cover so many football fields, a small amount of fibrin gets lined up in the vessel wall, and it consumes the entire fibrinogen fibrin supply, and the woman's system crashes. So this is what happens. Either it is consumption, and hemodilution, or some liver factor, or a disseminated intravascular coagulation. Now for us, what is important? I've been focusing on the coagulopathy part of it only, because brilliant speakers after me are covering rupture uterus and all. I will not touch that. And I should not, though I can. And diagnosis is many a times clinical. And what is there in clinical? This is important in clinical. Anticipation. He is anticipating that he is playing basketball, and he is anticipating where the next person is going to hoop. And see, this is how he becomes alert. So that is where anticipation in previously healthy women, dilutional coagulopathy is not usually observed until approximately 80% of the original blood volume has been replaced. 80%. So therefore, anticipating is critical. Regular body monitoring coagulation test results in all women who require a massive transfusion, that goes without saying. But this 80% is critical. I'm going to come back to that soon. And here I'm introducing a new terminology. Since last 4 or 5 years, I always bring in certain allied aspect. And here for this lecture, this is that allied aspect. And I'm introducing you to a new terminology. We all know the terminology where we use homeostasis, not hemostasis, homeostasis. And there is an allied terminology, allostasis. I'm introducing you to this terminology. Homeostasis is where the system equilibrium is maintained. And we are all in homeostasis right now. Everything is fine. What we call as we are in a cushioned environment. We are all in what they call as a safe zone or comfort zone. But allostasis is the process of maintaining this homeostasis through adaptive changes of the body's internal environment to meet perceived and anticipated demands. And that is where we come in. That is where we can step in anticipation, catching it at allostasis stage and not when the homeostasis is already disturbed. By regularly monitoring coagulation test results in all women who require a massive transfusion or are going towards massive transfusion, even before she shows clinical features of coagulation disruption, we pick up the ongoing process of allostasis. And that is where we have to catch before the hemostasis is disturbed. And repeating that slide, anticipation is the key. Be prepared. She is bleeding. And she is bleeding. In a previously healthy woman, dilutional coagulopathy, as I said, is not absorbed till 80% is blood, original blood volume has been replaced. Regular monitoring of coagulation, this diagnosing at this stage gives more time to take effective steps. And if findings are abnormal and ongoing bleeding is now in conjunction with oozing from puncture sites, mucous surfaces or wounds, it means the system has failed. Now full bone crisis is going to develop. Therefore, laboratory diagnosis comes in. And that is where coagulation tests are important. I'm going to make them simple, as clear as possible, because there are majority of you, or the 240 people who are listening to this lecture and watching me here, are clinicians. And for them, coagulation tests are a maze. You know, they feel very confused. But actually, they are complex, yes, but they are not difficult. And I will try to make them as simple as possible. But with respect to Einstein's words, that when you make things too simplistic, you are telling lies. I will not make it simplistic, but I will try to explain as Richard Feynman used to explain physics and quantum physics. But these are my areas of interest nowadays. Quantum physics, I'm learning Spanish, and also I am full-fledged into Zumba dancing. So these are the things of my hobby these days beyond academics. and therefore he will not lose the true sikor prothrombin time. PT measures the integrity of extrinsic system. Our teachers taught us there is an extrinsic system and there's an intrinsic system helping it out, as well as factors common to both systems. Activated partial thromboplastin time, APTT. I'm not going to mention about CT, bleeding time, clotting time. It's obsolete. A woman can bleed to death and still her bleeding time, clotting time may be normal. A woman may not bleed and still her BT and CT may be abnormal. So we keep it out. I'm not going to keep into discussion the modern lecture. So an activated partial thromboplastin time measures the integrity of the intrinsic system as well as factors common to both. Assisting them are INR, platelets and fibrinogen. All of these must be available in Rudrapur of Madam Chairman, must be available in Haridwar, must be available everywhere. There's no problem with that. Now let us see quickly prothrombin time. Told you, assesses the status of coagulation system, measures these factors. Basically, it measures how long it takes for the blood to clot. And the typical reference range is 11 to 13.5 seconds. Just remember this, 11 to 13.5 seconds. And APTT, it measures these factors 1, 2, 7, 5, 8, 10, 11, and 13. I don't want to 12, don't want to make it boring. But APTT measures the overall speed at which the blood clots. You know, you take time to reach a particular point, and you go at a speed to that, and that typical reference range is around 30 to 50 seconds. But something which is relied upon a lot these days is INR, International Normalized Ratio, the preferred test of choice to assess the risk of bleeding. And the INR is calculated by the patient's prothrombin time divided by the controlled prothrombin time. And a result of what is expected, but up to 1.5 is allowed. Is normal. Aim is to keep the value less than 2. Before it goes, strikes even 1.6, you have to start acting. And I will be coming to this very quickly. We now come to our reliable friend. And our reliable friend here is platelets. Clotting factors, including platelets, are consumed in the development of massive PPH. Measurement of platelets is contributory in diagnosis. Platelets are transfused with an aim to keep a platelet count of more than 50,000. Today in Facebook, somebody has asked, 69,000, what should I do? Dance, nothing is going to happen. Dance, everything more than 50,000 is fine. By and large, nothing happens. But be alert, that's all. Other recommended lab tests, we know this, hemoglobin, potassium, ionized cork, calcium acid for ABG, and central venous oxygen. A 2015 study has shown that during early postpartum bleeding, hypofibrinogenemia is a very important factor. We have by and large forgotten hypofibrinogen, but in early postpartum bleeding, this can help you. So please get a fibrinogen done. Point of care technologies such as thromboelastography and rotational thromboelastometry can identify decreased fibrin clot quality, even quality during PPH. Clot quality is not good, and this will correlate with low fibrinogen levels. So ask for fibrinogen. Having diagnosed the condition, we now come to the management. I've been given 25 minutes and I'll finish in 25 minutes. Okay. Remember, in management, we follow a rule of 30 here in where you are managing coagulopathy. 30% loss in blood volume, there will be a moderate shock. Systolic blood pressure falling below 30 mmHg, heartbeats rise by 30 beats per minute, respiratory rate rise to 30 breaths per minute, urine output less than 30 ml per hour, and Hb drop by 30%. These are not good signs. This woman is sinking. We are losing her. Be fast. And this is where, what will be our resuscitation targets. I'm not going into others. People will cover management of PPH in general and massive PPH also. But for me, if you call me at the scene, then this will be my target. Platelets more than 75,000, fibrinogen more than 2 gram, and PT, APTT less than 1.5. So this is where the whole thing, 1.5 times the control. This is critical for us. Of course, calcium and temperature are important and they are contributing. So this is a general management. We now come to the specific management. And this is where replace model has been lost in PPH. Previously it was said blood for blood, but it has gone much beyond. Plasma volume required for perfusion replace after 1 liter loss of fluid. Routinely we see that 1 liter loss of fluid occurs even following a cesarean section, but after beyond that, 1 liter fluid replacement, red cells required to carry O2 blood replace after 2 liters, if needed with O negative blood, and coagulation factors and or platelets for coagulation restoration replace after 5 liters loss, FFP, cryo, and platelets. This is important. Be alert. And who will assess the blood loss? Objective assessment. And if you can't, then no problem. Tell the anesthetist to. If you can't be objective, tell the anesthetist. They will always have a bias for increased blood loss. Telling increase. A surgeon always underestimates the blood loss. The obstetrician, the anesthetist always overestimates the blood loss. Good. Let there be an overestimation in this situation. That's fine. Now, I would like to tell you here one thing, that no such rule of thumb recommendation is available based on evidence. This is what the experts tell, and that is what we follow. This you can call as a category C type of evidence, where the experts tell you and we do it. Work is going on to standardize it, but somehow there are technical difficulties of confounding variables coming in, and therefore they are not coming out so well. Now our blood saviors, I am not speaking our saviors. I am not speaking of whole blood here. This is something which is important for us when we are handling coagulopathy. Science of fresh frozen plasma. Infuse fresh frozen plasma beginning with 4 units and following with additional units to normalize the coagulation test findings. This should be your aim. Normalize the findings. Many authorities recommend the addition of 1 unit of FFP for every 5 units of PCV. For every 5 units of PCV, add 1 unit of FFP, even if the bleeding has not started clinically. Because you are acting at the stage of allostasis. This is where you step in. What does it contain? It seems to be, Archana ma'am was telling about Ma Ganga. This seems to be the Ganga Jal. All clotting factors. Fibrinogen of 400 to 900 milligrams per unit. 1 unit of FFP. Plasma proteins, particularly albumin, which you require to hold on to. Fluids. Electrolytes. Hold on to fluids in the intravascular system. Physiological anticoagulants, which you need so badly. And added anticoagulants. These added anticoagulants you have to tackle by calcium administration at regular intervals. We'll not go into this. I don't have time for it. The generally cited dose of plasma required to reverse a coagulopathy is 10 to 15 ml per kg. So if a 60 kilograms of lady, our average lady, develops a coagulopathy, she will require 900 ml of FFP and then assess it as per the clinical response and as per laboratory response first and the clinical response. In many institutes, the threshold for transfusing plasma is an INR more than 1.6. They don't even wait for 2. More than 1.6, you act and start giving FFP. Although traditionally fresh frozen plasma has been the product of choice for reversing a significant coagulopathy, the modern blood bank will have several different plasma preparations, which should all be equally efficacious in reversing a significant coagulopathy or arresting coagulopathic bleeding, which includes platelets, which includes even PRP, but IV platelet-rich plasma, but they have short cycle life. They have a short cycle life, and therefore I would still rely a lot on FFP. But if there is a specific deficit, then you can infuse those. You transfuse. That is the difference between infusion and transfusion. Infusion, a transfusion where you administer blood and blood products. Infusion is where you administer anything other than blood and blood products. So this is where we transfuse, and there we will transfuse as per need, but FFP remains your mainstay. Massive obstetric hemorrhage protocols are useful in facilitating a rapid transfusion if needed. These are available in literature, and I don't want to bore you. I know that you will always like to ask, why do you need a teacher when we have Google? This is available on Google, but a teacher filters, and this is what I'm doing right now, filtering the knowledge for you and bringing to you. I'll be answering this in my last slide where I end. Now, you require still more help, still bleeding, or even if she is recovering, you may still require more help, and that is where you will may be required to call upon to do a hysterectomy. This is where if you ask for help, you have asked for help long back, but even more qualified help if needed, because she has a altered coagulation profile and you might have to do a hysterectomy. A hysterectomy is recommended if medical and surgical measures prove ineffective. An early hysterectomy is recommended for severe bleeding as a result of placenta accreta or uterine rupture. Dr. Kavita is going to cover uterine rupture to the best of my knowledge, and therefore I won't come on her area. However, in women with uterine atony who have ongoing bleeding in spite of an adequate transfusion, it may be reasonable to consider, and I'm introducing you to those who may not be knowing, most of you must be knowing, activated recombinant factor 7, RFC7A, before a hysterectomy. We will not go into the fears of RF7A, but there are similarities in the management of transfusion and severe PPH to that of major bleeding in other clinical situations. But the pathological process that contributes to massive transfusion may necessitate a change in strategies. A splenectomy ending up in hemorrhage in a male, a liver rupture handling a massive hemorrhage, and that in PPH is different. And therefore, you may require a little different policy. It was first used 12 years back in Baroda, sparingly available now. This universal hemostatic agent has been effective, used in controlling PPH. The best available indicator for RF7A efficacy is the arrest of hemorrhage, which is judged by the visual evidence of will come. She will stop bleeding. Transfuse this. In case of intractable PPH with no other obvious indication for hysterectomy, administration of R7A should be considered. It has saved lots of hysterectomy. This is a new thing for some. Many must be knowing it. Another additional factor is pelvic arterial embolization. Bold radiologists are ready to do it. Technical success in patients with disseminated intravascular coagulation. This study, which has come in somewhere around 2020, the technical efficacy was in 9 out of 11 who are hemodynamically unstable, and 6 of 8 cases was compared, and it was found that PA is a safe and effective treatment option in cases of coagulation impairment when bleeding cannot be controlled despite hysterectomy. This is pelvic artery embolization. These are all people have tried and literature is available. So additional lessons. I'm about to finish. And I have taken 2 minutes more. I am on 26 minutes. 2 minutes more I'll take. Dr. Archana, madam, will pardon me. Hemorrhage lesson.
Madam, sir, there is no rule. Abhi aapke liye, it is all.
I will finish, madam, in 2 minutes. I have got only 4 or 5 slides, 6 slides remaining, but they are picture slides, so it will finish fast. Hemorrhage lessons for care. This is not a sum up of whole thing, but hemorrhage lessons for care. Don't be falsely reassured by a single HB result. I have seen that I have been called. Sorry, HB is 8.5. Not bad. Not bad. Not on one HB result. Consider concealed bleeding if clinical signs of hypovolemia is present. They say, sir, koi bleeding nahi hai. Concealed hai. Chalo aur dekho. Dundo usko. Wow, ek gana aata tha. Lightly, I'm telling, dundo, dundo re sajna, more balam, kaan ka bala. that way, please try to find out where she is bleeding. She is bleeding. Recurrent APH, pain or agitation are red flags in women with placenta accreta who are going to bleed severely. Placenta accreta bleeds and it bleeds. Expedite management of retained placenta. Call an active massive obstetric hemorrhage protocol, and therein the complications also will come in. Use misoprostol cautiously. This is for rupture, which it may call sparingly. Concerns about training and competence in hysterectomy. And this is where my previous speaker covered something on being prepared. This is where a team or people like Dr. Kavita can be called in, who are masters in hysterectomy. Concerns about the training and competence. If you are, and I have been called to carry out such hysterectomies, and which have definitely helped. So friends, in the last remaining 3 or 4 slides, this is massive PPH. Collect everything possible and run, whatever possible. I remember one of my students landing up in a massive PPH. That was the time I ran with O negative blood. I ran. It was on cross match. And she's fine. She is fine now in US. Everything is fine. But I know the hematologist who was called. He was very cross with me. I know. I agree. Because he was worried. And that time, advanced, these type of testings were not available. Therefore, but then you run. You and to hell. Friends, you always tell. Many people tell me, and my son always tells me, Baba, why do you require to still give lectures when Google is available? This morning I told him, he is in US, we talk with him every morning. And he told me, Baba, I said, today I have a webinar. And he said, lunch will be missed. I said, don't worry, it's a PPH seminar, so it will last long. Because dinner will be missed. I finished my dinner at 6. When you people were discussing international and all those things, I went and had my dinner. Because 6 o'clock, I can feel very hungry. I don't eat after 6. So that is where a teacher steps in. Because a teacher, Google may panic you. Or Google may make you feel on the other side, yeah, mere ko mujhe nahi hone wala hai. No, that is where the strength of the teacher comes. And because the teacher makes you well-read, because he or she is well-read, makes you well-informed, because he or she is well-read, informed, and he is alert. And that is where he comes out and helps you. And this is what my job was today, specifically told by Dr. Archana, that, sir, this is a big problem. You have to help out. And this is my hand, which is helping you out. I may not be present next time when Anupama is handling somebody's massive PPH. Why I am telling Anupama? Because I don't bless her with having a patient with that. But somebody where she has gone to help, these are the things which will help her get that 5 units per kilogram of, that means 900 ml of blood, PFFT will be required, INR should be less than 1.5, all these she will remember. So friends, to sum up, I have summarized this in a film. There might be some breaks because of this internet, but then be patient. What the film will last only for 1 minute. And I overstepped by 5 minutes. And this is the final message.